Hello all. It is September 8th.
With me here is Julia, who you may not recognize, but you also might from my, because she was the model for Shlonzion Alexandra in the Jewish Empire.
And we are going to the Cochin Heritage Center in Nevatim. That really is your specialty, isn't it?
I wouldn't say that it is, but...
You've fallen backwards into this.
What?
We have a third IKEA? למה היהודים מקוצ'ין יצאו מהודו? לא היה
אנטישמיות ולא היה זה. אני אציע לך עוד רעיון. אני אגיד לך, אני אספר לך. אבל אני יכולה להראות לך סרטון באנגלית, ששם גם מספרים לך למה הם בעצם עולים. אבל אני אגיד לך למה, קודם כל, אחר כך, אם תרצה תוכל גם לראות את הסרט שיש פה. בסדר?
בסדר.
אז היהודים עולים לישראל רק מטעמי ציונות, אוקיי? ולכן גם הם לא עולים לפני הכרזת המדינה, הם מגיעים לפה רק אחרי שהכרזו על המדינה, כמדינת יהודים, ואז הם עוזבים את הכל, הם מוכרים את הדברים ועולים לארץ ישראל. הם לא מסתובבים בעולם, הם באים רק לארץ ישראל. הם באים לכאן כיוון שזאת זה המקום שהשם הבטיח לנו, מה שנקרא, לשנה הבאה לירושלים, שהכריזו על המדינה, אז הם כתבו לשנה הבאה לירושלים הבנויה. וזאת הסיבה שאנחנו כאן.
בסדר, תודה רבה.
Here we have all the different Jewish quarters in different cities in Kerala.
So you're a student in Jewish history?
Yep.
I need to know, is there still a taboo against medieval Jewish history?
What do you mean taboo?
Like Tanakh lepalmach, skipping over the sad parts, I guess, the shameful parts, supposedly.
So there's it's getting disrupted. Shalom, boker tov. There's in the 1930s or so, there's a professor in Columbia, Jewish history professor, Sal Baron, mm-hmm. and he basically wrote against this whole idea that the medieval period of Jewish history was in fact shameful. He called it the lachrymose approach to Jewish history, and the idea that everything was so bad. He was challenging those assumptions with the idea, you know, Jews were very self-autonomous in those periods. They were definitely, their situation was way better than the majority of Europeans, the European Jews, way better than being a serf and things like that. So a lot of, you know, modern Jewish historians challenge those assumptions that are definitely still widely held by, like, you know, the average person. But it's up for debate.
Okay, very interesting. Yeah, this is going to be the background image for the video.
Oh, the synagogue?
Mm-hmm. It's the only synagogue I've ever known to have a screen door. Yeah, the red one, that works.
The red one goes well with your shirt.
Yeah.
I don't know how exactly... Is that it?
Yeah.
It's too small to be a regular hat, but too big. In my experience, to be a kippah.
The bigger the hat, the closer to God, Sam.
Many parts of the synagogue were brought by the Jews from Cochin all the way to here, from the suburb of Cochin or Nakula. You'll notice it's in the shape of a keyhole, because it's considered this is the gateway to heaven. So that's a theme that we see in a lot of the Cochin emotes. Instead of just reading from the Torah here, they would also take it up to the women's section, and the men would read it from there as well. The idea is, it's a holy day, we're taking things up to another level, literally.
Huh.
Okay, so since I'm here, I want to do some notes about synagogue architecture. If you are American or otherwise from the English-speaking world, you're probably used to all the pews facing in one direction like a church, and that's actually a very modern development. Traditional synagogue architecture has the bima in the middle and the pews surrounding it. Now, what's interesting about this is that there's actually a really old conflict about which way the synagogue should be oriented. So, in Ashkenazi synagogues, traditionally the entrance faces toward Jerusalem. But in other synagogues, it's the Aron Kodesh, the cabinet which contains the Torah scrolls, that faces toward Jerusalem. And here, it's the latter. This way is north, this way is Jerusalem. What's interesting is that this debate didn't originate in Europe. It actually predates the destruction of the temple. Like the old Caesarea synagogue is actually oriented towards, with the entrance toward Jerusalem, and that's why I drew it that way in my map back in the Jewish War series.
There are a few that have been preserved in Cochin itself and the surrounding areas, but those are basically tourist sites. Here, there's a quorum, there's a prayer quorum 3 times a day, 7 days a week. So this is essentially the only, you know, there are other Cochini communities that pray, but this is, as it were, an original one with the original, you know, furniture and elements. Another unique custom is that instead of having, let's say, a rabbi officiate a wedding between a bride and groom, the groom himself is the one who officiates. So he marries himself to his wife, to his bride.
Huh.
So there are a few things like that, but in general, Cochini Jews, they fit in the rubric of traditional historical Jewry.
Okay.
Cochin be al karke shalom. Nanu brana. אני פוחדת לדבר.
כמו אני בעברית.
I'm afraid.
כן. נמסכם. הייתי לידי אנבטי מוניל ישראל. ישראל ואני ואני פתקם ונדי כפר בטיפי. דרך עברי ודיעית, סוכנות ודיעית. പഠിച്ചു അവിടുന്ന് വന്ന് സഭയിൽ പോയി. സഭയിൽ നിന്നും ഇവിടെ വന്നു. ഇവിടെ വന്നപ്പോൾ 55 വന്നു. 55 വന്ന് അന്ന് മുതൽ ഇതുവരെ ഞാൻ ഇവിടെ തന്നെ മോശാവിനെ പറ്റി.
Special thanks to my patrons, including my Geonim, Lev Cham, Vicky Nelson, and Orvice.